Yeah, as a mental health provider, I think that's what comes up because we know the research shows that having an abortion doesn't lead to depression, anxiety, PTSD, but not having the freedom to have bodily autonomy and make choices regarding your body and your future and your current family and all those things does have an impact on depression and anxiety and specifically maternal mental health. And being able to choose when and how you're going to grow your family is really, really important. So I look at that as we try, as they're trying to restrict access to abortion and make it more difficult to, or to overturn it, it's going to shift problems. It's not going, it may solve this sliver of a problem that we're thinking we're trying to solve, but ultimately isn't the solution. And so, from a mental health standpoint, that's where my advocacy really increases. Simply being in a state that we're one of the highest fam or highest for children and families, and wanting to reduce postpartum depression and anxiety, and again, being able to grow your family in a way that fits is a really important piece to that. So that's heavy on my mind and is and really drives why I want to continue to be a part of this.
So I'm feeling all sorts of emotions right now. I am recalling back, oh my gosh, when my daughter, who is now 32 years old, we went to a protest at the Capitol when she was a toddler, a young, an older infant, and I remember having her in my backpack and going to a rally at the Capitol. And over the past few years, I'm thinking, well, we've making movements, we making movements, we making movement. And then to be where we're at presently, just where it's very heavy on my heart, that daughter of mine just had a little girl last year, brand new baby. And it's baffling to me that I'm thinking about the things that I was worried about for my daughter. 30 years ago, when we were at that rally, and now I'm thinking about that for my granddaughter, and the fact that we still have to have these same conversations and these dealing with these same myths and misconceptions and fighting the same fight. But it is crucial, it is important. All of these attacks on access and care are meant to obfuscate. They're meant to confuse, because it even goes beyond what Dr. Shaw mentioned about just that direct access. How do these services get offered? But the fact that that the legislation is being run, that the courts rule the way they do, are there to intend to confuse that young person or that person wherever they are, regardless of their age, in an isolated area, who now just knows, that I can't get an abortion. What am I supposed to do? And so it's for that person that I keep working, and I think we all feel that way. And I encourage those that are watching. It gets discouraging, but I think of the women that went before me and the women that went before them to fight for women's health care and for reproductive justice and for justice generally, because this is a power and privilege issue at its core. And we have to fight for it in that regard, for all those women, and for the people to come to have that access.
Thank you, Rebecca. I feel like that was a perfect ending to this conversation. I really appreciate each of you for taking the time to share your thoughts and feelings and experiences with us today. And I'll just say that I feel lucky to be part of this group and to be part of this movement. And, let's keep going. We'll keep going. So thank you all.
Thank you.